Hello everyone, welcome back. So today in this session, let us see electrostatic potential and capacitance, which is the second unit, that is second chapter, electrostatic potential and capacitance. So in this video, I will be discussing about electrostatic potential only. In my next video, I will discuss about the capacitance. Okay. First, let us see what is the meaning or the definition of electrostatic potential. Electrostatic potential. Okay. It is defined as the work done by a unit positive charge, to move from infinity to that point, in the direction opposite to the electric field. Okay, this is mathematically written as V is equals to W by Q, where V is nothing but electrostatic potential, W is work done, and Q is charge. Okay, now let us move to the first derivation, which is very easy. Let us see. The first derivation is electric potential due to a isolated point charge. In my last video, I told you the meaning of isolated. Once again, isolated is nothing but which is alone or which is single. Single point charge is nothing but an isolated point charge. Okay, for this, let us first consider a point charge Q. Let Q be a point charge. Let E be the electric field produced by this charge. Okay, let A and B be two points, and let P be at a distance r from Q. Let this A be at a distance x from Q. Let one coulomb of charge be placed on A. Okay, you will come to know why I am placing this one coulomb of charge here. Because according to the definition of electric potential, work done by unit positive charge to bring from infinity to that particular point. Now, here the purpose of introducing this one coulomb at A is, we are going to calculate the work done by this one coulomb of charge to move from A to P. According to the definition, one coulomb of charge to move from A to P. Then we will clearly get what is the work done or electrostatic potential. Okay, let us see first. According to Coulomb's law, we know that F is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1, Q2. But in our case, Q1, Q2 are, one is charge Q and the other is 1. Therefore, Q into 1. And the separation between them is X square. Okay, this is the Coulomb's law statement. From that statement, we have written F is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q into 1 divided by X square. Okay, next one. Now, let 1 coulomb of charge move from A to B. Getting? Let 1 coulomb of charge move from A to B. Then we know that work done is equals to force into displacement. Is it clear? Now observe the diagram. If I take this small distance as dx, then my displacement here will also be dx. And already we have calculated the value of force here. Therefore, replacing this force here, that is, I will take it as small work done dw. F value is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by r, not r, x square. Q by x square. Displacement is dx, but according to the definition, if electric field is moving this side, our charge is moving opposite to the direction of electric field. Therefore, when it is opposite, we have to take it as minus dx. Therefore, this equation will be dw is equals to minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by x square dx. Is that clear? This is for how much? From A to B. Now total work done by the system to bring charge from infinity to P. Why? Our intention is to bring this 1 coulomb of charge from A to P. Therefore, from A to P, total we are talking about. For one or small distance, we have taken dW. For overall, we have to integrate it. Therefore, integration of dW is equals to minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by x square dx. Okay, next one. Let me continue it here. Next. Now, here clearly d and integration get cancelled. And this side, constant things will come out. What are the constant here? Constants are, first of all, negative sign I will take out. And q by 4 pi epsilon naught also will come out. Therefore, left out with only integration of 1 by x square dx. But one thing we are missing out here, integration from where to where? As we know that integration or charge is moving from infinity to P, therefore our integration will be from infinity to R. Why R? Here the distance of P from Q is R. Therefore, till here, our point charge is moving from infinity to P. Therefore, at P, we have R. Therefore, from infinity to R, we have to integrate. Therefore, this will be infinity to R. Therefore, using integration, that is minus Q by 4 pi epsilon naught. This will be integration of infinity to R x power minus 2 dx. Therefore, by using a formula, that is integration of x power n dx is equals to x power n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. This is the standard formula used in integration. Therefore, next, this when we apply to this equation, we'll get minus q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught integration of infinity to r. This will be, no, when we are integrating, we don't need to write this. Therefore, x power minus 2 plus 1 divided by minus 2 plus 1 from infinity to r. Therefore, this will take a form that minus q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught, that is x power minus 1 divided by minus 1 from infinity to r. Next is equals to again minus q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. This will be, this can I write it as 1 by minus x. Why? Because in the numerator we have minus 1. When that minus comes to denominator, it will be plus 1. Therefore, this is from infinity to r. Here clearly minus minus get cancelled. Left out with only q by 4 pi epsilon naught. Now taking the upper limit first, that is 1 by r minus of 1 by infinity. 1 by infinity will be obviously 0. Therefore, we are calculating work done, that is W is equals to q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into r. This is the equation for work done. And as you know, work done is equals to W is equals to potential. Therefore, this can be written as V is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by r. This is the final equation of electric potential due to a isolated point charge. Okay, next derivation let us see. Okay, next we have expression for electric potential due to a dipole. Okay. First of all, what is a dipole? A dipole is nothing but pair of charges equal in magnitude but opposite in charges. That is, consider a dipole, that is minus q and plus q, separated by a distance, the separation between them be 2a. Okay. If the total distance between them is 2a, from the center, this will be A and this will be A. Let P be a point at a distance R from the center. Therefore, joining these two sides, let this be R2, let this be R1. Okay. Now, let this angle be theta. Okay, this theta is nothing but the angle between the line joining the dipole and the point P. Okay, the line joining the dipole and the point P. Now, according to the equation of potential, okay, potential at P due to positive charge Q is given by V is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by distance is R1. Therefore, the second one, potential at P due to minus q is given by, that is, V is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught minus q divided by r2. Why? Because the separation between them or the distance between minus q and p is r2. Therefore, this can also be written as v1 and v2. Why? Because according to superposition, principle of superposition, we can add these two charges, which I am going to do in the next step. That is, v is equals to v1 plus v2. Therefore, v1 value is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by r1. Next, this will be plus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught minus q by r2. This can be written as common things are 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Q is also a common thing. Therefore, in bracket, 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Why? Because here minus sign is there. Minus into plus will be minus. Therefore, let us take this equation as 1. Equation 1. Let me take this center as O. Let me represent the center as O. And I get two triangles here. That is, first triangle from triangle O, let me name this, that is A and B. O, B, P. That is O, B and P. Okay, from triangle O, B, P, cos theta. Cos theta is equals to, cos theta is equals to. Now, according to cosine rule, I think you have forgotten what is cosine rule. First, let me explain you what is cosine rule. This cosine rule you have studied in first PUC, that is in the chapter motion in a plane. What does this cosine rule says? This cosine rule can be applied or applicable for any triangle. If I take alpha, beta and gamma as three angles, then according to cosine rule, sides A, B and C, cos alpha can be written as, that is cos alpha. Okay, opposite side should be taken as negative, remaining two sides should be added. See, that is cos alpha is equals to b square plus c square minus a square divided by 2bc. Divided by 2bc. Similarly, when you solve for cos beta, opposite should be negative, these two should be added. That is a square plus c square minus b square divided by 2ac. Similarly for gamma, cos gamma is equals to, opposite should be negative, remaining two should be added. That is a square plus b square minus c square divided by 2ab. 2ab. So this is the rule for taking cosine, that is cos of alpha, beta and gamma. But how is it useful in our derivation here? Just see here, we are also having one triangle with angle theta. When we apply cos theta, what will be our equation? According to that rule, opposite side should be taken as negative and remaining two sides should be positive. Therefore, two sides are r and a. Therefore, r square plus a square minus r1 square divided by, remaining things are 2 into r into a. Getting 2 into r into a. Next one, cos theta into 2ra is equals to r square plus a square minus r1 square. Clear? Let me just rub this. Next step, from this, my intention is to calculate the value of r1, that is taking r1 towards that side and bringing this cos theta 2ra this side. What will I get? Just see here, that is, this is negative, if it goes that side it will be positive. R1 square is equals to r square plus a square minus of 2ra cos theta. Okay, now taking common, that is r square. If I take r square common, this will be 1 plus a square by r square minus 2 r a cos theta divided by r square. Here r and r get cancelled. Left out things are r1 square is equals to r square into bracket 1 plus a square by r square minus 2a cos theta divided by r. Now here I have a square. If I take square that side, that will be under root, and that under root of r square into bracket 1 plus a square by r square minus 2a cos theta divided by r. Here square and root get cancelled, but one more root will be there for whole bracket, that is r1 is equals to r. Under root can also be written as 1 by 2, therefore I directly write it as 1 plus a square by r square minus 2a cos theta divided by r whole power 1 by 2. Now next step, taking reciprocal. What you will get when you take a reciprocal? This will be 1 by r1 is equals to 1 by r into 1 divided by 1 plus a square divided by r square minus of 2a cos theta divided by r whole power 1 by 2. Reciprocal means taking it into the denominator. Okay. Now just see here. In the denominator, it is 1 by 2. Positive 1 by 2. If it is taken in the numerator, this becomes minus 1 by 2. That is 1 by 1 divided by r1 is equals to 1 by r into 1 plus a square by r square minus 2a cos theta divided by r whole power minus 1 by 2. Minus 1 by 2. Is this clear? Understanding? Yes. Next step. If r is much greater than a and r square is much greater than a square by r square can be neglected. Therefore, neglecting this complete term, that is 1 by r1 is equals to 1 by r into 1 minus 2a cos theta divided by r into whole power minus 1 by 2. Okay, next step, by using binomial theorem. Okay, from binomial theorem we know that 1 minus x whole power n can be written as, or is written as, 1 minus nx. 1 minus nx. What is there in the power can be written with the coefficient of, can be replaced with the coefficient of x. Therefore, applying that thing to this particular section, that is 1 minus minus 1 by 2 2a cos theta divided by r. This minus into minus will become plus. Therefore, this will take a form, that is 1 plus 1 by 2, 2, 1 by 2 in, will be in the denominator, 1 by 2, a cos theta into r. Clearly, 2 and 2 get cancelled. Therefore, this particular thing can be replaced here. That is 1 by r1 is equals to 1 by r, this thing, that is 1 plus a cos theta divided by r. 1 plus a cos theta divided by r. This is the equation for only 1 by r1. Okay, I am rubbing this part. That is, now similarly for r2, r2 will also be the same, but only there will be a change in sign. Similarly for r2, 1 by r into 1 minus a cos theta divided by r. Therefore, let me take this equation as 2 and this equation as 3. We already have equation 1. Replacing the values of equation 2 and 3 in 1, substituting 2 and 3 in 1, we get, what do we get? V is equals to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught. 1 by R1 value is 1 by R 1 plus A cos theta divided by R minus of overall bracket 1 by R1 R2 is equals to again 1 by R into 1 minus A cos theta divided by R. Here clearly this minus sign will be multiplied and this will be cancelled, that is minus into plus minus 1 and 1 will get cancelled and common things are 1 by R. Therefore I take common as Q by 4 pi epsilon naught into R. 1 by R I have taken common, left out with only these two terms. This will be minus into minus, it becomes plus. Therefore A cos theta by R plus A cos theta by R will be 2 A cos theta divided by R. Okay, this equation, can I write it as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q into 2A cos theta divided by R square. Check. I just multiplied it back again and multiplied R with R. Therefore, here you can see momentum, that is P is equals to 2Q into A. Therefore, replacing this P in this equation, we get V is equals to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught and P cos theta divided by R square. So this is our final equation for expression for electric field due to a dipole. It is very easy, students. It is a bit lengthy, but if you remember the things where it is little bit complicated, it is a very, very easy derivation. Okay. So this was all about electrostatic potential. In the second part of this chapter, I will be telling you about capacitance, electrostatic capacitance. So till then, take care, study well, and please don't forget to subscribe. And please comment and tell me, did you like the video or no? Thank you so much.